You ask me these questions. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't have the answer. There's something wrong with my brain. I can't put two and two together. I can't understand.
Matt was our only child. He was introspective, but he had a strong emotional intelligence. He could, from a very early age, tell us how he was feeling, if he was sad, if he was happy, if he was excited.
He always seemed to have a good idea of who he was.
To us, he was everything.
I remember the first day that I met Bob and Linda, and how, just seeing how much they loved Matthew and how much they yearned to have answers.
It was a really pretty June day. Matthew was playing upstairs with a friend, and I heard his friend say, "Mrs. Dahl, Matt fell." I ran up the stairs, and his friend said, "No, he fell out the window." I didn't know whether we had lost him. His doctor came in and said, "We don't know if he'll survive. And if he does survive, you have to be prepared because he might not be Matthew anymore." We heard, "Mom!" And his first question was, "Will I still be smart?" I thought, oh man. You know, it's like we had him back. He was checked out by Children's Hospital, and it's like he's good to go. And it never circled back for the next 14 years. It had happened and he had recovered, and aren't we lucky?
Right. We won the lottery.
These injuries certainly disrupt the structure, but they also can disrupt the function. And everybody who has a traumatic brain injury, their brain does its best to respond and react. Unfortunately, the brain isn't very good at healing itself.
It was the fall of his sophomore year, and I got a call at work. He said, I something's happening. I can't make sense of things, and it's scaring me. So I went to the doctor, and they diagnosed him with depression, a major depression, and started treating that. That was the beginning of a five-year struggle. And he had ups and downs, tried many therapies, was hospitalized, changed doctors several times, all sorts of medications, and just seemed to be slipping further and further away from himself.
Depression and different psychiatric changes happen in people with traumatic brain injury. That's something that we are all trying to understand. But with Matthew, he is a very unusual case in a person who had an injury very early in life and had 2 decades for that injury to progress in his brain. And yet he died at such an early age.
I think Matthew held on to hope until almost the very end.
He was still working, still living on Beacon Hill with his friends, and, you know, still having a reasonably normal life until the fall of 2018. And at that point, he just went into one of these sort of downward spirals.
It's almost a guarantee that Matt's brain was compensating for his injury. There's no question about that. But part of his injury was not going to get better.
And I said to him, "You're my boy, and I'll never stop fighting." And he said, "Mom, I'm not your boy anymore. That boy is gone." And I think he just knew in his head that he wasn't the same person, and he felt he wasn't going to get back to being that same person again.
"But I don't mean that my life is destroyed. I mean my way of living is destroyed."
What does that mean?
Whatever connects yourself together and your mind is gone.
Bob walked into the condo with Otto under his arm. Bob just looked at me and he shook his head like that. And then the two guys walked in after him and I said, I don't want you here. And they said, I have to say the words. Your son Matthew died today. And he was gone. But I'm gonna keep my promise. I'm gonna keep fighting for him because we think that that is what he would want.
When we first saw Matt's brain, you could clearly see the injury to the back right of his head back here.
Several times, he would point to his head and he would say, but my brain is dying.
But it was only after we were able to get an MRI from Dr. Christine McDonald, you could see injury deep into the white matter, up to the front of the brain, injury in a lot more areas of the brain than we ever would have detected as a pathologist.
We're not getting Matt back, but what would the best possible thing be? We agreed that it would be to validate Matt. At the end of the meeting, I said, Dirk, we didn't know what we were going to hear today, but what we wanted to hear was something that would validate Matt. And he said, well, you've got that.
To be able to tell Bob and Linda, Matt wasn't wrong. Right? He knew there was something that was happening to his brain.
You know, it all makes sense now. He wasn't getting better.
And thanks to the hard work of my team and everything coming together, we were able to show Linda and Bob all of the damage that we found in Matthew's brain.
Because of the work that Dirk and his team have done, it's now not nearly so mysterious.
But there's a whole journey that we have to go through until we get there. Traumatic brain injury research is in the earlier stages, but that's another reason that Matthew is such an important donor, because we lack the fundamental knowledge of how the brain is structured and how it works. We got a lot of work to do. We have so much work to do. We can't solve any diseases until we really understand the normal brain and then what's happening with a traumatic brain injury, but we're getting there. We're seeing early results that are really encouraging.
One of Matt's friends distilled it down and said, so someday, some little kid's gonna hurt his head and he's not going to have to suffer like Matt did. And that's what we're hopeful for. And that's what we feel is Matt's legacy.
I'm so hopeful. It gets me up in the morning thinking, you know, we're going to make a difference today. We're going to understand something. We're gonna make that discovery.
And that's the hope.
That's where the hope lies.
Do you feel our love?
It feels great. I love you too. I always love you.